Hey guys, it's me Tara. Welcome back to my channel. If you're new, subscribe down below because why not? Today we're gonna be reading The House on Mango Street, chapters 25 to 26. So let's get started. Geraldo, no last name. She met him at a dance. Pretty too, and young, said he. Said he worked in a restaurant, but she can't remember which one. Geraldo, that's all. Green pants and Saturday shirt. Geraldo, that's what he told her. And how was she to know she'd be the last one to see him alive? An accident, don't you know? Hit and run? Marin, she goes to all those dances. Uptown, Logan, Embassy, Palmer, Argan, Fontana, the Manor. She likes to dance. She knows how to do cumbias and salsa and rancheras even. And he was just someone she danced with. Somebody she met that night, that's right. That's the story. That's what she said again and again. Once to the hospital, people, and twice to the police. No address, no name, nothing in his pockets. Ain't it a shame? Only Marin can explain why it mattered. The hours and hours for somebody she didn't even know. The hospital emergency room. Nobody but an intern working all alone. And maybe if the surgeon would have come, maybe if he hadn't lost so much blood, if the surgeon had only come, they would know who to notify and where. But what difference does it make? He wasn't anything to her. He wasn't her boyfriend or anything like that. Just another brazier who didn't speak English. Just another wet back. You know the kind. The ones who always look ashamed. What was she doing at 3 a.m. anyways? Marin, who was sent home with her coat and some aspirin. How does she explain? She met him at a dance. Geraldo, in his shiny shirt and green pants. Geraldo, going to a dance. What does it matter? They never saw the kitchenettes. They never knew the two-room flats and sleeping rooms he rented, the weekly money order sent home, the currency exchange. How could they? His name was Geraldo, and his home was in another country. The ones he left behind are far away. We'll wonder, shrug, remember. Geraldo. He went north. He never heard from him. We never heard from him again. Chapter 26. Edna's Ruthie. Ruthie, tall, skinny lady with red lipstick and a blue babushka, and one blue sock and one green because she forgot, is the only grown-up we know who likes to play. She takes her dog Bobo for a walk and laughs all by herself. That Ruthie. She doesn't need anybody to laugh with. She just laughs. She is Edna's daughter, the lady who owns a big building next door. Three apartments front and back. Every week, Edna is screaming at everybody, and every week, somebody has to move away. Once she threw out a pregnant lady just because she owned a duck. And it was a nice duck, too. But Ruthie lives here, and Edna can't throw her out because Ruthie is her daughter. Ruthie came one day. It seemed, out of nowhere. Angel Vargas was trying to reach us to was trying to teach us how to whistle. Then we heard something whistling, beautiful, like the Emperor's Nightingale. And when we turned around, there was Ruthie. Sometimes we go shopping and take her with us, but she never comes inside the stores. And if she does, she keeps looking around with like a wild animal in the house for the first time. She likes candy. When we go to Mr. Brenny's groceries, she gives us money to buy her some. She says make sure it's the soft kind because her teeth hurt. Then she promises to see the dentist next week. But when next week comes, she doesn't go. Ruthie sees lovely things everywhere. I might be telling her a joke and she'll stop and say, "The moon is beautiful like a balloon." Or somebody might be singing and she'll point to a few clouds. "Look, Marlon Brando," or "Sphinx winking," or "My left shoe." Once, some friends in Edna's came to visit and asked Ruthie if she wanted to go with them to play bingo. She wondered whether to go. "Should I go, Ma?" she asked the gray shadow behind the second floor screen. "I don't care," says the screen. "Go if you want." Ruthie looked at the ground. "What do you think, Ma? Do what you want. How should I know?" Ruthie looked at the ground some more. The car with the motor running waited 15 minutes and then left. We brought back the deck of cards that night. We let Ruthie deal. There were many things Ruthie could have been in if she wanted to. Not only is she a good whistler, but she can sing and dance too. She had a lot of job offers when she was young, but she never took them. She got married instead and moved away to a pretty house outside the city. Only thing I can't understand is why Ruthie is living on Mango Street if she doesn't have to. Why is she sleeping on a couch in her mother's living room when she has a real house all on her own? But she says she's just visiting, and next week her husband's going to take her home. But the weekends come and go, and Ruthie stays. No matter. We are glad because she is our friend. I like showing Ruthie the books I take out of the library. Books are wonderful, Ruthie says. And then she runs her hands over them as if she could read them in Braille. They're wonderful, wonderful, but I can't read anymore. I get headaches. I need to go to an eye doctor next week. I used to write children's books once. Did I tell you? One day I memorized all of The Walrus and the Carpenter because I wanted Ruthie to hear me. The sun was shining on the sea, shining with all his might. Ruthie looks at the sky and her eyes got watery at times. Finally, I came to the last line. My answer came there, none. And this was scarcely odd because they'd eaten everyone. She took a long time looking at me before she opened her mouth. And then she said, "You have the most beautiful teeth I've ever seen." And went inside. And that is the end of chapters 25 and 26. Thank you guys so much for watching. Be sure you like this video, subscribe down below, and stay tuned for the next chapters.